Now let's continue further and about our skills still and look at some different things. One, let's look at problems likely to be encountered by a narrator on stage during a presentation. You get a question in an exam. You have been given an opportunity to present a narrative before your class. But at the end of the performance, the teacher says your performance was not effective or successful. What might have gone wrong? That is a question asking about the shortcomings of a presenter on stage. The shortcomings of presentation. Problems likely to be encountered by a narrator on stage during presentation. What are some of those things that you might encounter, you are likely to encounter as a narrator on stage during presentation? One, there's something called stage fright. Stage fright, when the first time you stand on stage, you'll feel jittery. You'll feel some form of fear that grips you. You'll be anxious. It's called stage fright. You'll be fearful. You'll be unable to present. It's called stage fright. You experience that most of the time. Even a musician, the first time you go on stage, if you're a footballer, the first time you play in a very huge stadium, you experience what you call stage fright. You're a form one, the first time you're told to present something before a parade, you'll experience what we call stage fright. So stage fright is one problem likely to be encountered by a narrator on stage. Inaudibility is the second thing. Inaudibility. You are not audible enough. If you're not audible enough, your narration will not be effective. Your presentation will not be effective. So you need to be audible. You need to project your voice to be heard by everybody within that hall, that class, that parade. But inaudibility is another problem. Thirdly, inability to fully capture the audience's attention. Inability to fully capture the attention of your audience. That is a shortcoming. That is a problem. If you cannot capture the attention of your audience, probably your presentation will not be effective because you need everybody on board. You need everybody to be attentive and to follow you. So if you cannot capture the attention of the audience, trust me, your performance will not be effective. Number four, there's something we call an illogical flow of ideas. If your ideas do not flow, you are writing a story and then people cannot follow you. You are giving a speech and you are giving points from number 1 to 10, but your points do not flow. If we call it illogical flow of ideas. If you have experienced that in a presentation, your presentation will not be effective. Number 5, there is something called challenge of maintaining eye contact. If you cannot maintain eye contact with your audience, your presentation will be ineffective. You need to maintain a meaningful eye contact with your audience so that your performance is effective. Very, very important. Let's go further and look at the signals, signs of fright, nervousness, anxiety on the part of the presenter or the speaker or an interviewee. What are the signs of fright? What are the signs of nervousness? You're asked to present, or you went for a drama festival and you presented a choral verse before an audience. But the adjudicators indicated that you were nervous, that you showed signs of fright. What could have made them to come to such a conclusion? One, what are the signs of nervousness? One, if you're shaking, it shows you're nervous. Sweating shows you're nervous, mostly sweating palms. Heart held on the chest or mouth, it shows nervousness. Shuffling of your feet on the floor. Leaning forward on the seat if you're an interviewee. Inability to speak clearly. All those are examples of nervousness, anxiety, on the part of a presenter, a speaker, or an interviewee. Shaking, sweating, some sweat profusely, even from the forehead, you can notice they're sweating. Hands held together on the chest, shuffling of the feet on the floor, leaning forward on the seat, or inability to speak clearly. All those are examples of nervousness. Now, causes of fright, nervousness, anxiety, uneasiness on the part of a speaker or a presenter. What are the causes of nervousness? One, unpreparedness. If you're not prepared, you'll experience nervousness. Lack of confidence, number two. If you lack confidence, you'll experience nervousness. Intimidation from the audience. If an audience intimidates you, trust me, you'll experience nervousness. We have some audiences that are very intimidating. Some will jeer, some will point fingers, some will mock you, some will make faces. That is a form of intimidation. So if you face intimidation, you'll become nervous. What are the ways to overcome fright? What are some of the ways to manage to overcome stage fright? One, take a deep breath between stanzas or lines in order to gather courage anew, afresh. Breathe in, breathe out. Take a deep breath between stanzas. Secondly, maintain eye contact with the audience. Thirdly, be confident in yourself. Be confident in yourself. Fourth, move freely on stage from one point to another. It's a way of overcoming nervousness. Reassure or encourage yourself that your audience is harmless. It's human like you. Crack a joke that will divert your thoughts, which are probably the source of fear, and hence gathering courage once again. Crack a joke that will divert your thoughts, which are probably the source of fear, fright, and hence gathering. Crack a joke in between your performance. What are some of the indicators of active participation of an audience in a performance? We talked of nodding, clapping, joining in singing, completing statements, putting interjection utterances, shouting, stamping of their feet. Now let's look at the reasons for eye contact. Why do you have eye contact either in a performance, in an interview, in a presentation? Why eye contact? One, you get the feedback from the audience. You know how they are reacting to your presentation. You get feedback through eye contact to give your audience a positive impression about yourself. If you maintain eye contact, you will give the audience a positive impression about yourself. Thirdly, to impress their moods. To impress their moods. Eye contact helps impress the moods of the audience. Functions of pose during presentation or a performance. What's the function of a pose? Why do people pose in between a performance? One, to draw the attention of the audience. Two, to allow the audience to think, to internalize what they say. Thirdly, to achieve suspense. One, to draw attention of the audience. Secondly, to allow the audience to think, internalize what you've said. Thirdly, to achieve suspense. Reasons why the speaker, the narrator, can begin a conversation or a story with a surprising question. Why do narrators begin their performance with surprising questions? One, to create rapport with the audience. Secondly, to create a sense of suspense or curiosity. Thirdly, to introduce a comic story, create a sense of humor, to place a story within a given time frame or lengthen the time, to tickle the minds of the audience. Aspects of oral performance in an oral poem and their effectiveness. Aspects of oral performance. Repetition is used for emphasis and memorability. Idioms, they make the performance interesting. A conversational style or direct address, you make the poem immediate and effective. The use of conversational style or direct address is to make the poem immediate and effective. Use of short and simple stanzas. It makes it easy for the audience to participate in the performance by joining in. Use of short and simple stanzas is to make it easy for the audience to participate in the performance. Aspects of speech that the speaker needs to consider for effective communication. What aspects of speech do you need to consider for effective communication? One, age of the audience. Secondly, the relationship between the speaker and the audience. Thirdly, the topics of discussion. Then the language of the audience. Age of the audience is very important. Before you give a speech, consider the age of the audience. Consider the relationship between the speaker and the audience. If I'm a Christian and I'm addressing Muslims, that is the relationship. If I'm an elderly and I'm addressing kids, that is the relationship. Then the topic of discussion. Some topics are sensitive to a particular group. Then we have the language of the audience. Which language are they familiar and comfortable with? Lastly, let's look at the features of effective direction. If you want to give direction, what are some of the effective features that you need to consider? Precise and clear. You need to be precise and clear. Secondly, you need to be correct. Thirdly, systematic and logical. Follow a systematic order. Presence of landmarks. Presence of present approximate distance. Now, sensible reasoning. It should be sufficient. It should lack ambiguity and multiple interpretation. Now, we'll stop there for today. Thank you for your time. We'll continue further discussing things to do with oral skills because it's quite a large area. All I need from you is that you keep reading and acquainting yourself with some of the details under oral skills, because these questions are never direct. These questions, when they come in an exam, they need you to apply what you already know. They'll not ask them directly. So kindly be reading them time and again to be familiar with them. Otherwise, thank you for your time.